Holy shit, we're in this. We're fucking in it. What is up? This is the Shits Opened podcast, video cast, bullshit, quarantine, another white guy thing. The Shits Opened podcast is an idea I've had quite some time. From this idea of, opening the shit up, so to speak, of just like, fuck it. This, no filter. Let's just figure it all out. All the weird, all the crazy, all the esoteric. And guess fucking what? We're in the fucking middle of it. Right fucking now. And this is just going to be sort of like a pilot episode, a sort of test episode, and see if we can even fucking do this right. I don't even know how it's going to fucking sound. So, my co-pilot on this fucking shit rocket is my buddy Zach.
Hey, hey.
Okay, I can hear him, so we're already at a good start. Okay, Zach, before we dive into the shit, introduce kind of who you are, what you do, and really I want you to describe where you're at right now, like in life. What's been going on? Because you have a lot fucking going on.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. There's been a lot going on and not going on, I guess.
Right.
So my name's Zack Jacobs. That's who I am. What do? I just recently bought a bar, the Ottawa Tavern, on Adams Street. and I play music and stuff and do theater. That's kind of... Those are the things I do. I chill pretty hard. things are definitely it's a weird time right now, Ian. It's a strange time to be alive. Strange thing to live through. But just kind of taking it a day at a time. Trying to focus on like one positive thing that happens every day.
Right. Yeah.
Sometimes it takes a little digging, but you could even just be like, hey, my cat came and sat on my lap today, and he was very snuggly. It's a positive thing.
Yeah, just take the small victories, you know?
Yeah, so, just been doing a lot of that.
And I definitely want you to kind of hang on to a little bit of that in your memory, because we're definitely going to dive into, the necessity of the small victories and all that stuff, because I'm sure we're going to get to that point of opening shit up a little bit.
Shit's open.
Shit's fucking open. Oh, we'll get there. I mean, you're drinking a stiff drink. I'm drinking some stiff drinks.
Oh, I deserve this today, believe me.
Oh, yeah. You're when we were texting earlier, you were saying you were having a goddamn day. So we're gonna open it up.
Small victories, Ian.
What's that?
Small victories.
well, for those who don't know, obviously Zach mentioned he opened up a owner of the Ottawa Tavern in Toledo, Ohio, and literally had that sumbitch opened for 3 days?
Yeah, I mean, 2.5. We had like a soft opening, and then Friday and Saturday we were open.
Yeah, you're a little soft here, soft opening Friday, but then you got a little more blood flow on Saturday, Sunday?
Sunday we got closed before, like, I found out the news right as we were going to open the bar that bars were supposed to be closed at 9. So I was like, okay, well, I'll just, not turn on the sign. And a couple of people, like friends and stuff, showed up like, hey, I want to get one last drink at the OT before
right.
Close for how long, and I want to support you. And, I was planning on coming out here a lot. Now I get 3 days of it kind of thing. but you were there. You were there Friday.
Was there that Friday, and it was lit. It was your dad celebrating your dad's birthday, celebrating the opening.
Mm-hmm.
You started on some solid tugs on Friday, getting really working it up. Saturday, you had a fucking rock hard. You were ready to go full force. And then Sunday, you didn't get your cummies.
Yeah.
That's literally what happened.
It was like the blue ball of business.
Yeah. I think everybody's sort of feeling that right now. And
yeah, that's true.
A little both literally and figuratively. But obviously I've, and many of those close to you have seen the effects of it. I've known you for 15, 16 years.
Yeah, I think something like
You know,
that.
it's we've known each other a long time, and I've seen you in many forms, in many situations, in many emotions, and obviously, this has been a lot, you know. And so, for those, obviously, you won't know because this is not even a thing yet. We haven't even released this idea of shit's open. I have this sort of motif that I have that I was sort of inspired from. I used to work at a factory a long, long, long time ago, over in Fremont, and there was this guy I worked next to. His name was like Michael or something like that, and he was this kind of weird looking dude, and he always had a "Don't tread on me" shirt. Really, really weird dude. And anytime that one of our coworkers were trying to talk about like politics or like sex or something like that, this guy would always have a response of "No sex, no religion, no politics in the workplace." You know, and I always found that funny because those are the three kind of core things that everybody seems to have as pillars within themselves. You know, their sexuality, who they are as, you know, a sexual identity, two, where you stand on a, you know, political compass, you know, and three, you know, what do you believe, you know, existentially or spiritually? You know, I feel like a lot of these things come from the same place. And I always found that super interesting. And another thing I not necessarily find interesting, but I am a self-admitted dumbass. And I want to learn, I want to be better, I want to grow. And so sort of the purpose of this journey that I myself am going to take. And once you obviously have really good friends like Zach, you know, impart his wisdom and his life experiences, and that I'll learn even more about him than we've known since, you know, 2000 fucking five, you know. And but the goal is to get more guests, people I don't know. I want to get people who, you know, maybe not get don't get a lot of, you know, representation. You know, get trans people in here, people of color, you know, women, and any walk of life. I want them to come here. And I have sort of whittled down sort of five questions that are going to be sort of the backbone of every episode. And as we're kind of going through each question, we're going to open the shit up a little bit.
Oh, there he said
I said it. That's the thing.
it.
And once we get a little more official, we'll have like sound effects, like all that shit. But yeah, I feel like I have it whittled down to five kind of core questions. And what we're going to do is through those questions, explore not only the history, you know, of why you believe what you believe or what's motivated you here, but then kind of expand on it. And maybe, you know, not only will I learn something, hopefully, you know, the person through conversation might learn something, and then any listener who's going through this might learn something or have a different view. Because, you know, I definitely try and want to have some representation of all sides. You know, I want to have lefties, righties, middlies, all of it, you know. So looks like you're opening something. Are you trying to do a sound effect?
No,
I
you've known me for too long.
know, like I saw the white glow.
Well, now I can't do it for a while. I want you to forget. And then when
Okay.
I bring it back, it's going to hit really hard.
All
It's
right. Hell yeah, dude.
going to be so fresh. It's going to be transcendental.
All right. Well, I'll wait for the surprise. So, enough fanfare, enough explanation. Let's get into the shit and open it. All right, question number one I have here is, first and foremost, what are your spiritual beliefs right now? And once you give me that sort of explanation, what pushed you towards that belief system?
All right, well, we're opening with a softball question. Real
Oh, yeah. We're just lofting it.
slow ball over the plate. Easy to answer question. So my spiritual beliefs right now are, not necessarily, they're very much, I want to say, my own conclusions I've arrived to myself.
There are many like it, but this one is your own.
Yes, exactly. And it's really complicated for me. But in my weird personal insanity, it makes sense through my own logic and probably mental gymnastics and the justifications we give ourselves and everything. But yeah, I mean, if the short question is like, do you believe in a god or some higher power or something that's out there that we don't understand, then the answer would be yes. To me, is it necessarily an old white guy in a robe and a long gray beard? No. Would it be kind of sweet if it was? Yeah. He's just like the Family Guy version of God, and he's just like a bro, and he's like, hey, what's up, man? How about my motorcycle and whatever?
That would be sick. Yeah, I would
Yeah.
love God's Harley.
Right. But, it's not really in an alignment with any sort of organized school of thought or particular religion. I'm definitely a person that believes that there are many paths to God or just even enlightenment in yourself, whether it be a God, many gods, no God. To me, it doesn't really matter. And the thing that I believe in, if there is some sort of reward or punishment, which I don't even think that there's, whatever.
Yeah, that's a whole other thing.
That's a whole other thing. That it doesn't really matter. Like, what you do in your life and how you treat your people around you, the fact that you left the world a better place than it would have been had you not existed, that to me is like the ultimate test. You know,
Right.
when you say these words from this book or these words from this other book, or you wear a hat, or you don't wear a hat, or you do this kind of thing. I think that's, it's definitely tradition and it's important to some people's core, like, values and faiths. But to me, I just try to live my life as a good person, be good to the people around me, love first, try to understand first,
Right.
and, if the world is a better place for even one person after I'm long gone, then that will have been worth it. And I think that's kind of, to me, where I come from as a person, like in my spirituality.
So I correct me if I'm wrong here. 'Cause I that's very beautiful. You know, I feel like I align in that realm, definitely. But it feels to me that you sort of through time have adopted, I want to say, an agnostic approach on some things because you definitely have, you know, there's something here, there's something, but ultimately, your morality is follows the compass of legacy, you know, what you do here, what you do with your time here.
Right.
And when you're gone, what is your legacy? What is that going to be? You know, are going to people going to reflect on Zack Jacobs' life and go, "Holy fuck, that dude was a twat," you know, or are they
Probably
going to go,
could.
"Could probably could," you never know. I mean, that's one of my biggest fears. I, you know,
Once
rattle
this
in my,
episode comes out, there'll probably be way more people actually that think that.
but or you know, are people going to, you know, look back and say, you know, Zach was an incredibly nice person. He was funny. He was kind. You know, these are all really good motivators. Before we dive a little bit more into that, because I feel like there's
Oh,
a little
there's a lot
deeper.
more to it. That was like just,
Yeah, that's a synopsis.
that wasn't even really a synopsis. That was just like the beginning to open shit.
All right,
I think
right.
like we can get into how I arrived at all those
Yeah,
things
but that's the follow-up question. What
later on.
pushed you towards that belief system?
Right.
Let's start in the beginning. You know, what were you raised as?
I was raised as, so I'm a confirmed Lutheran.
Oh,
I'm
confirmed. So you got like
Lutheran,
Twitter verified by Jesus?
yeah, I got the
By
Lutheran
Luther
mark,
Jesus?
my name. I'm verified in the eyes of Lutheran Jesus and
Hell yeah,
Moses.
dude.
But no, yeah. So I grew up in Woodville, and went to Solomon Lutheran and was confirmed there and had an amazing pastor, actually, Pastor Duty.
That's awesome.
And he was very much the person that instilled to me in like reading the red words, you know, with that phrase, like when you listen to what Jesus had to say.
Right.
You know, if you go by that model and not necessarily ignore all the other stuff that happened before or whatever, but just understand that the commandment of that is to love thy neighbor as you love thy God, and in doing so you're loving God and, you know, just loving people and treating them well.
Right.
He wasn't at all like a very fire and brimstone kind of guy, or a particularly anti-gay, or any of those kind of anti-abortion, any of those kind of traditional values. And so that was really cool. And really, to me, also, like, my parents weren't, you know, they grew up in the church too, and, you know, came from kind of religious backgrounds and families, but they weren't necessarily, like, in a way forcing it. Like, they're like, hey, if you want to do this, like, it'd be cool if you did it, kind of thing. We're not gonna
Right.
force it down your throat. We want you to make up your own mind. Sorry, my cats are beating the shit out of each
Kittens.
other.
Nice.
Yeah, that's a good time for it. But, you know, it wasn't a, oh, you have to go and do this, or you're kicked out or shunned or whatever. So it was really cool to have that openness, that breathing room to kind of explore my beliefs. And this was a thing, like, this was one avenue, I believe, towards that, you know, the answers to all of these questions, these big questions
Right.
that we all freak out about, because nobody, I mean, it's kind of unanswerable. But to have that kind of that space to grow and make your own decisions and actually find a really cool place to land and learn about who you are as a person and your own spiritual self, was really cool. So I was pretty much church every Sunday until about age 12 or 13. And then, you know, I hit a, you know, preteen to teenage early years is probably the harshest. And somebody who was very close to me, my grandma, my Cleta, had died when I was 13. So that, on top of just the normal weirdness of being a 13-year-old boy in a small town kind of thing, sent me into a really big depression. And I definitely was, you know, I was turning not as just against God or the idea of religion, but kind of against everything. You know, when you're that young and in such a weird formative time of your life, you can't really take it on the chin as well. You know, you're not really equipped to deal with that sort of shit, so you lash out in really unhealthy and fucked up ways. And so that kind of ended really at that point of any belief in, I mean, it wasn't like just that one thing. It was like the perfect storm of a bunch of shit culminating in my life that led me to really kind of disown any sort of belief in a God. And not even to the point where I was just like, hey, I've read this book, you know, by Stephen Hawking or whatever, and, you
I
know,
have some literature.
it was literally just like, it was like, fuck God. You know, I was like this rebellious asshole teenager, and it wasn't necessarily, I was just like an atheist. It was like, I was just pissed off at really everything, and I didn't know how to express myself. So that was teen years. And through the lack of self-expression and the lack of an outlet or any sort of healthy coping mechanisms that we learn and develop over the course of many painful battles that make us up as human beings, you know, drugs definitely became an outlet and escape to that. And, you know, it was pretty much just anything I could get my hands on for a while. and I eventually ended up just becoming heavily addicted to opiates, actually, for a number of years. And really, it was more of an internalized thing because I was able to really keep my shit together, more or less. Like, I remember, having 3 jobs and going to college, or having a bunch of
And
my.
still being an opioid addict.
Yeah, and I graduated with straight A's and shit. Like, it wasn't really affecting any of that stuff. Functional addiction, I guess.
Yeah, and
It's really
that's.
kind of an oxymoron because you're not functioning as you should be if you're dependent on this thing for motivation or energy
Right.
or happiness or any sort of feeling. Because that's the thing, that's the lie that they tell you is that drugs are bad, right? Drugs are really fucking good, actually. And that's the problem.
Actually, yeah.
Because it replaces, not all drugs, like, so there's some really stupid drugs.
All right,
But
right.
if it be, it has the potential to be the feeling that you always want to feel in spite of everything else. Oh, I don't need to have this connection with a person. I don't need to have this connection with a god or a belief, even not even god, let's just say a belief system or anything really, because I have this thing, this constant that is always there kind of thing. So that was, for me, it was definitely a battle for a number of years. And there was, of course, all the ups and downs of recovery and going back and all this. But eventually, kind of what, bringing this back around to the belief and everything is when I was finally done, just kicking it. And it wasn't even a thing that I had planned for a while. It was like, I just more or less one day woke up and was like, I'm fucking sick of this. I'm sick of being sick. I'm sick of not living and not feeling anything besides fear and sickness.
Damn.
And so I just kind of went through it, like all the withdrawal and shit, and I just went cold because I'd done programs in the past and stuff, and some of them had helped in ways, but mostly it felt like just being another cog in a wheel, another means to an end for these companies to make money off of me, truthfully. That's not me saying I'm anti-therapy or anything, like, please
Right.
go to therapy. There's really good therapists and really good help out there. It
Right.
was just what I was accessing at the time was helpful in ways, in other ways it was like I just needed to do it on my own.
Right.
So I just kind of went through it at home, and there was a point where I was really sick. Basically just couldn't get off the couch for weeks or days at the time. And in the peak of it, I was pretty sure I was gonna die, actually. Like, it was like the closest
Right.
I'd ever felt to that. And I had, I guess, like a moment of clarity, as they say. It was like, and I'll never forget it. I mean, this is years ago. It'll be in June, it'll be 9 years from any of the bullshit.
Right.
So it was just like just a warmth and a light washing over me and a presence, and it felt so familiar, like something that was always in you that kind of just opened its eyes. And I felt peace. I felt my grandma. I felt okay. And it wasn't even like words were spoken. It was like one of those things where it didn't have to be. There wasn't like some grand message. It was just like, you're not alone in this. And it was, completely eye-opening and cleansing in so many ways. Like, it
Right.
was just like a blackness being busted out by light. And it sounds incredible and almost too good to be true. And maybe it was just the hallucinations and ravings of a spaced out drug addict, but at the time I hadn't done any of the shit. It was all coming out of me.
Right.
So it kind of made me think, whoa, holy shit. After I had gotten through it and had time to go back and really process the whole thing and what I experienced from not just, just everything. I was like, wow, that happened. That was pretty fucking weird. And what does that mean? What was that?
Right.
And so, that was kind of one of the really cornerstone moments in my life of kind of shaping my weird patchwork of beliefs.
Because pseudo Christianity, but not necessarily Christianity, but just sort of
Yeah, I mean, it's
some
like,
form of Gnosticism.
definitely. I mean, I love me some Jesus, but I love some Buddha. Like, Muhammad said some good stuff. Like, there's all eternal truth in a lot of these things. There's no really, I don't think there's like really one pathway to that. I think the people who got it right are the people that are like, love each other, be good to each other, take care of each other.
Yeah, don't be a fucking
That's
dick.
what you really should take from it. Be a good fucking person. Don't expect a reward. If you're being a good person because you think, well, I'm going to get into heaven, you're kind of missing the whole point.
Right.
You should just be it because being good is the reward in itself.
Right.
Not a what's in it for me. It's a how can I help make just the world? Because why would you not want to live in a more beautiful, loving, peaceful world? I don't know.
Right.
To me personally. And of course, I'm still an asshole in like day-to-day random moments, but that's
Right.
generally overarching with how I try to live my life.
Yeah.
Sometimes like I haven't eaten for like 6 hours, and I'm like, wow, fuck everything or whatever, but
Oh, so you're telling me you're human. Got it.
I do get hangry, guys. Just the
People tend to forget that part.
So yeah, that was kind of a real redirection on that path.
Okay.
And it wasn't like I was like, oh, I gotta go back to church or anything like that. Like, not that I'm gonna get go to church if you wanna go to church and everything. It was just sort of, okay, I can walk this path
It
because
was a self-affirmation that it was all you needed. It was like that sort of like nod of like, all right, this is okay.
yeah, definitely. And it really helped me, like.
Yeah, I can see that. The way when you talk about the experience, because the trajectory here is you have a belief, and then you don't have belief. And then through a happenstance moment, you've sort of stumbled upon and refound a belief. And as time and experiences has gone on, it just sort of became its own thing. It's become the church of a ZJ, Zack Jacobs, the church of
Right.
Zack Jacobs. Yeah, you
Coming
know?
to you 2021.
Right, exactly. No, I never knew that about you. I never knew. Your opioid addiction.
That's there's gonna be a lot of people if anybody actually watches this,
Yeah.
if any of my family watches it,
Right.
there's gonna be a lot of people that are gonna be like, wait, what the fuck?
Right. No,
I
but
held it very well. And actually, like the way I look now, like I look like a I mean, I probably don't look like, but I totally look like a guy that does way more drugs than the guy I looked like 10 years ago. You're
I'm
like
not. I know what exactly you looked like 10 years ago. And
super normie,
oh yeah.
like, can't.
Polos, short hair, glasses.
But, appearances are something to be said of themselves, I guess.
Okay.
But I think
So,
it kind of
go
also, every time I talk to people about that, they're like, I never would have guessed. And to me, that's fucking sweet because I don't want to come across as the guy that used to like get so high, like just be blasted into the void, fucked up, like
Yeah.
to recover and repair is something, I guess.
So, okay. Your motivator towards that belief system was essentially your recovery from addiction. It was that beautiful shining light moment of that warmth in you. And what I find very interesting about your moment, and again, correct me if I'm wrong, because I tend to be that a lot. You sort of have come to a comfort of, even if that was just chemicals, just being fucking wonky, even if you're still cool with the notion of that was comforting, and at the very least, it was a reminder of shit's going to be all right.
Yes.
You know, and to kind of reevaluate yourself and to be a, aspire to be a better person.
Right.
That's awesome, dude. That's a lot deeper than I thought I was going to go with it.
Yeah, shit's opened.
It's open right now because
I'm okay with being wrong too about this. Like, even if I'm wrong at the end of the day, I'm not going to know until I'm dead. So either I'm dead and I'm just fucking dead, or I'm dead and there's something else beyond this thing. And it'd be sweet if it was, you know,
the good thing.
But it really costs me nothing. Not that I have like cheap beliefs, but at the end of the day, if you want to, I'm not going to go out and try to radicalize or proselytize to anybody about what I believe.
Right.
Like, I want to live that example rather than being like, hey, this is what I think, and you should think the same thing because I'm right. It's more like, hey, this informs me as a person. This is the place I come from. And
don't be a dick.
If the end result is I'm a better person from it, then I think that's okay. You know, if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. I'm also the person. I'm a gigantic science nerd.
I know that about you for sure.
I'm never gonna be the person like, that's not possible because God did it, actually.
Did you know the banana is shaped?
Yeah, it's shaped to fit perfectly in your hand.
Yeah, just God, like my dick.
And, you know, if that's the case, and again, I could be wrong. Doesn't really seem to be that way. Seems like evolution and natural selection kind of is shaken out to be what went down.
Well, careful, those are trigger words.
Oh, trigger warnings.
Trigger warnings.
It took how long into this? We're actually doing okay.
Yeah. We'll be all right. We're not going to get banned just yet.
Not just yet.
No, but there's two things. Do you have another point?
No, go for it.
Okay. So there's two things that I want to note here. The first thing, and something that I've sort of been ashamed of, and I feel like is going to be either a point of interest on the podcast or a point of annoyance on the podcast, is there's a lot of things in this brain. A lot of it is useless information.
Big same.
And one of the things that while you're talking about that, you're talking about, you know, this belief system of, you know, many roads going to the same thing, you know, loving, you know, the word of Buddha and Muhammad, you know, and just, and there are many paths, but they all ultimately end at a same goal. And there is a belief system like that. There is a religion that is like that. And the name is escaping me. But the useless piece of information that I have about this is, do you know the band Seals and Crofts?
Mm-hmm.
You know, the summer breeze makes me feel fine. Apparently, like, in their older age, they are, like, huge advocates for that religion.
Well, that makes total sense.
Yeah, they're, like, super. And it's a really long and weird name, and I can't remember it because I'm a dumbass. But the piece of useless information while you were talking about that, I'm like, ha! That's the Seals and Crofts religion.
We're bringing it back around to the music. You know?
Yeah.
How could you not write that song if you weren't, like, super in touch with yourself spiritually and just like chill as fuck, you know?
Oh yeah, you look at some of the song titles like Hummingbird, you know, like some very nature-esque stuff. Yeah, they're in it. But the second point I wanted to hop into, it's going to kind of transition to the second question I have, is the aura you're giving, especially with you know what you've told us so far, is a lot of who you are as a person and in your, at least currently your spiritual beliefs is openness. Is openness with the aspiration of just trying to do a greater good.
Yeah.
You know, not necessarily by the motivation of hell or anything, but just it's the right thing to do. You just kind of do it.
Yeah, I'll never claim to have a monopoly on wisdom on any topic, and especially about the infinite unknowable.
Right.
You know, so if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. Also, if you believe something differently than me, that's cool, as long as it doesn't cause harm or pain or hatred towards yourself or anyone else, for like no reason, you know.
Right.
Then cool, like that's great. Are you a good person? Do you try to live your life in a way that you want to be good to the people around you? Great. We can vibe. But anyway,
yeah, so. No, this the when what that transition is okay, you have this open aura about you. You're a very open person, and yeah. I hate, and I don't say this ironically, I hate to ever assume, but I correct me if I'm wrong. I'll make an assumption here, because the next question is, what are your political beliefs and what motivates you and pushes you towards that political belief? I think who you are as a person already, you know, spiritually and just who I know you to be, I feel like your political leanings are very open, you know, with garnering more towards the compassionate side of things, of, you know, humanitarian leanings, you know, a little bit more, essentially poor people say more liberal leanings nowadays, you know, the hippy dippy stuff, but with an openness of being wrong. I don't want to call you a moderate because I hate titles, but like, I feel like you have an openness. Are you as open politically as you are spiritually?
Yes and no.
Okay. Lay it on me, dude. Let's fucking go. Shit's open, bitch.
I think that question two is way more complicated and controversial than question one.
Okay. Especially in these times.
Yes.
These inject yourself with bleach times. Yeah.
Yeah. So that kind of leads me to my point, is there are beliefs and then there are facts. I don't know for absolute fact. I can't say 2 + 2 equals a fact about my spiritual beliefs. That's just what I believe, and I have faith in that. So that's, there are facts, which is 2 + 2 = 4. And every possible conceivable way, that's just the fucking truth, right? So that's where I'm definitely like open to people that have different beliefs than me politically. And I'm like already getting fired up and like pissed about it. Like,
no, this is what I want. Let's go.
Gloves up. Shit's open.
It's open, bitch.
Commence the revolution. No. yeah, I would say that I'm very much an open person politically. I want to think that I'm a moderate person.
Okay.
In everything, I was you know, I was raised, and I guess I'm still being raised. I don't think you're ever stopped being raised by my mother and father, who are a Democrat and a Republican. And neither of them are really extreme one way or another, and they are both, I mean, they're both very pretty moderate in their ways.
That makes sense.
Yeah. Like they both kind of cross-sect each other in certain beliefs in ways that you wouldn't anticipate of somebody that would never vote for this party and somebody who's always voted for this party.
Right.
And so I guess that kind of also informed me in my political upbringing, in that I was kind of just left the space to figure it out for myself.
A lot like your religious.
A lot like the religion
upbringing.
My parents were just shit. So they were never really forcing me down one tube or another. They were just like, hey, do good at school. Don't be a fucking piece of shit. Wash your hands before you come to dinner.
Do your thing.
Cool.
Hell yeah.
And, you know, I mostly did those things. Mostly. And so where I came to my political awakening was kind of around that time that we talked about, like 13-ish, which I was born in 1990, so that would have been 2003. So that's the beginning of the Iraq War.
Old Bush.
Old GW. And so woo! I got to, you know, that catastrophe fuck, as we all did. Oh, here we go. Take a chug on the chat for GW.
Woo woo!
So, you know, I definitely didn't understand a lot of shit about the world at the time. and kind of was informed by different, mostly comedians actually, like Jon Stewart and different
Ironic, yeah.
that, you know, kind of they actually informed me more than if I were watching just. Yeah, did I?
Oh no, you're cutting out.
Hang on, I did something.
You did something.
Dick Cheney is on the chat.
Wait, hang on. Okay. Trying to censor me, bro. Can you hear me?
I can hear you, I just don't see your face.
Oh, here we go. What? There we go.
Oh, you back.
Sorry. Dick Cheney caught wind of this Zoom meeting, so he tried to shut it down.
NSA, we're not talking shit. We're just opening
Yeah.
some, we're just having a talk right now, right?
I love it. All of it. Thank
Well.
you. So, I don't even remember the fuck I was talking. Yeah. So, like,
We're in 2003, Fuse is on TV,
yeah, Steven's Untitled Rock Show.
Untitled Rock Show.
What's your political stance on that? Steven, I identify politically as Steven's Untitled Rock Show. But, you know, so obviously, long and short of it is I'm more of a left-leaning person, like definitely in a lot of aspects, but I'm also, again, very open to, first of all, being wrong. I'm a weird person in that I like being wrong
Like
in a lot of
weird.
ways because that means I learned something that I didn't know. I grew. I was like, oh man, I always thought it was like this thing, but I just found out I was totally full of shit. And then, like, you become better from that, actually. People get so pissed off and so entrenched in their beliefs that they're like, hey, here is actual data. Like, smack them in the face with it. They're just like, no, I think it is because it is, and that's why it is. And you're like, but no, please, just listen. We made graphs and shit. Like, just hear us out.
Yeah,
And
I'm that stubborn person a lot.
it's hard
I'll admit
not to
that.
be. It's called confirmation bias. So it's like, it's everybody, it's ubiquitous. But I've really fought to have this, like, take on things that proof I want to be wrong about it. And that means that I grew and I now know something that I didn't before.
Love that. I admire that.
So in that way, like, I'm that, and I have certain views that aren't all the way in line with everything on the left.
Right.
Not in line with everything on the right, but you know, it's just more of when I come to talk to a person and to know a person, like, it doesn't matter as much to me. I mean, it does matter, but like who you voted for and of course what you believe, because that shapes who you are as a person.
Okay. Yeah.
But if you there's just certain shit that I think that people focus way too much on what makes us different than what we have in common. And I think that is kind of the big disconnect now between the left and the right. Because, I mean, it was already really crazy before all this. And now we're in a pandemic. And there was like a golden, like, week or two where everyone was just, like, scared as shit. And nobody was really fighting about, it's the Democrats' fault. No, it's the Republicans' fault.
No, it was
And
all.
it was like in a weird way, like, we all actually came together for once.
Yeah.
I mean, it was horrible, shitty fucking time, so I'm not gonna say it was sweet. But looking back on how that was and how we were treating each other to now, where every fucking time I open Facebook is this conspiracy. Or the president said this fucking stupid thing, which he says a lot of fucking stupid things. I'm sorry. But there's a lot of just divisiveness as if this virus fucking cares if you're a Democrat, a Republican, a libertarian, a socialist, an anarchist, an independent. It doesn't matter. Like, this should unite us more than anything ever. This is literally the definition of a common enemy. Right?
Right. Well, here's a sub question to that, if that's okay.
Yeah.
And this might take a turn. I'm kind of apprehensive. Okay, so I felt the same feeling you did, where we had that golden, barely a week of just like, this is new, and like, people that at my work who are super Trump, like they were kind of like being open and just sort of like, you know what, no, maybe this makes a lot of sense. And it was really like this, okay, we're all coming together. For once, there's no sides. It's not me against you. It is us. It's just all of us.
Right.
And then something happened. I don't know. Because nothing's really changed, really. Right. The circumstances are still the same. But what do you think is the motivator of divisiveness again? What do you think was the catalyst of togetherness for a brief moment, and then what was the moment that broke it up again?
Okay, so I think it's a multifaceted issue for me.
Okay.
And again, could be wrong. My take on it is that people are sick of staying at home. Like they're getting ornery. They're
cowards.
Great. They're
I've lived this life.
Right.
Gamer strong. Oh my god.
Yeah. Every gamer nerd like we're just like what
the like, shit.
Friday, whatever day it is. But they're getting like they're boxed up in their house and they're used to going out to TGI Fridays and fucking doing shit.
So I can't get my hair done.
They're getting ornery. They're obviously we're all just afraid of the economic repercussions. I mean, I hope that all of you guys who bought 8,000 things of toilet paper are doing okay out there right now, by the way. I just went to Meijer the other day, and guess what? They still got fucking toilet paper, you weirdos. So I had to look directly at the camera for that one.
Right? Yes, at you.
You toilet paper reporter and weirdos.
Fuckers.
So I think, you know, it's fear, anxiety, which are completely understandable reactions to
and
this.
Big motivators on a lot of things we do in life, also political and religious beliefs.
Mm-hmm. But I think that a lot of the politicizing, I don't think that it's necessary nor a good thing for anybody involved in any of this that the president does a news conference every day. Why? Unless he comes out and is like, hey, here's this new government program, or we found a fucking cure, or this vaccine's about to come out, or some actual thing. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not the guy that's ever going to root for this dude. But at a certain point, he's just kind of out there waffling around. Like, there's no new information, and it's just opening himself up to look like a dumbass because he is punching way up and speaking out of turn and out of his depth on things that he doesn't know about because he's not a fucking epidemiologist. He doesn't know viruses. He's just the guy. And he's like, we should probably just, like, blast some sunlight in it.
Yeah, how that work? Light? You put it in your blood?
You know, like, if I'm the guy that I try to see the best in everybody, and if he – I'll have the take that he intends to be a good person and try to do good things. I don't really think that. But just stop, dude. You know, it's not really serving anything. And all this, it's kind of fomenting a lot of dissent in a way that at first, when things came out, he was like, yep, we're locking shit down. This is the shit. This is fucking serious. There's at first, he called it a hoax and all that stuff.
Yeah.
But when it was like actually a problem, like you can't avoid it anymore.
He's like, all right.
He was serious about it. And now he's starting to kind of like, he's kind of starting to peter out on it and be like, you know, I mean, like, why does the president have a Twitter? He doesn't need a Twitter. Any president, like, I just want to pass constitutional.
Cheers to that.
You're not allowed on Twitter. I don't care if you're fucking Bernie Sanders or who you are. You don't got to be tweeting. You're the president. You got way better shit to do right now. Okay. So when he's starting to talk about, like, liberate this state and liberate that state and all of that, like, there are a certain portion of the population that are just going to have the worst interpretation on anything at all, really.
The government's too big, it's gonna control us.
Yeah, there's already a gigantic segment of anti-science, anti-vax, anti-government.
Yeah.
I'm not, like, all the way pro-government jerking off every member. Like, I think
they're all right.
Pieces of shit, honestly. Not all of them, but I think
burn it all down.
Really fucked up system. And when you already have that, and it's a weird, scary, unprecedented time for us as a society, like, nobody alive right now, really, except for, like, really fucking old people that lived through the Spanish flu. No, none of us have ever dealt with anything like this before, including our leaders. Right. And that's kind of showing you that nobody really knows what the hell they're doing. And maybe we should have a little bit more compassion for each other. And while we all, like, putz along and fake it till we make it through life, because like, it's all we're doing. Nobody really fucking knows. And so you have this undercurrent, this underbelly of people that are just looking for a fucking reason. Add that on top of, I'm stuck at home, my roots are growing out, this thing is shut down, I can't,
my nails,
like, people are pissed off, and I understand it's a gigantic disruption for everybody, and it's not just happening to you, it's happening, right? And like, right. People can't. And that still doesn't mean you're not allowed to be upset about it. You're allowed. For like the first 2 weeks, I would wake up at like 5 a.m. and like chain smoke cigarettes and just like cry while reading Twitter. I'm like, the fucking world's ending. Everything's fucked. And like, that's okay. I mean, it's not okay to like, but you're allowed to feel that.
No, it's that is okay. That's one of the mantras of, you know, why
it's okay to not be okay. Like,
yeah, that
kind of thing.
That phrase.
But you should still,
a little,
like,
bit of a trigger thing, but it's true.
Yeah. So I think it's just a real can of dog shit. Not even a can of worms at this point. The dog ate the worms, shit the worms, back into the can.
Yeah.
I also think that there's like a lot of just selfish people. Like, that's kind of the thing that is pissing. A couple of the things out of the million things that's been pissing me off about this is a lot of these protesters and stuff are people that aren't saying, I want to go back to work. Like, for me, if I have every reason to be out and, like, open up my fucking bar. We got to be open for 2 days and got closed down and don't qualify for really any government assistance because we don't have financials to provide to prove that we were really a fucking business.
Right.
We might as well have been a popsicle stand. Not to delegitimize all you popsicle stands out there watching, but I thought about popsicle stand. I forgot what I was saying. But no, it's people that are like, I want to get my hair done, aka I want you to go back to work. Not I want to go back to work. I want you to risk your life so I can get my roots touched up.
So I can enjoy a steak dinner, sit down.
I want to go to the movies. I want to go to Fuddruckers or whatever the fuck people do with their lives. And don't get me wrong, I do too.
Everybody does.
I miss TGI Fridays. Honestly, like, after this, I might go to like every douchebag bar in the world just to get my foot stepped on by 17 dudes named Chad and get bumped in. And like, I miss all of it. I miss everything. I miss my shitty old life.
Right.
But there's people that are like, so like that's first of all pissing me off. That isn't actually like the top thing. That was just the first thing I thought of.
Right. But
another thing that's been pissing me off is all of these companies that are running like advertisements and billboards that are super duper self-aggrandizing bullshit, being like, hey, to all of our Kroger's workers out there, we want to say thanks. And like, there's like a billboard downtown right now of like a thank you employees thing. Like, okay, or how about instead of running ads on Spotify thanking your Kroger or whatever essential employees, you take that money and you fucking give it to your employees.
Hazard pay!
You provide them paid sick leave so that if they get the shit, they're not bankrupt.
Right.
And it's just kind of, it's so disingenuous and self-aggrandizing to me. And it's fucking bullshit.
So you're telling me, Zach, you're telling me this capitalist society...
Don't get me started. Shit's open.
Shit's open right now. No.
It's like everybody wants to like pat themselves on the back for just saying thanks and not actually doing anything.
Yeah.
You know, being like, hey, you're our heroes. Thank you for being heroes. Instead of being like, hey, here's money for your family, or here's personal protective equipment so you don't catch this disease and die, or spread it to somebody you love who could die. It's a fucking billboard.
So
this plasticine culture, this pat on the back bullshit, is so stupid to me. It doesn't make any fucking sense. I don't see anybody on any side benefiting from it other than this like corporation's brand image, but it's kind of backfiring because, like, okay, for like 3 seconds you're like, you feel all warm and fuzzy, you're like, yes, they are heroes, and like, don't get me wrong, they absolutely are. Like, I'm not minimizing that at all. People are still working at McDonald's or the hospitals, or anybody that's still working and risking this shit is bad fucking ass, and you got my respect.
Respect.
But they should have more respect for their people than to do this sort of just jerk themselves off kind of thing. You know?
It kind of reminds me of anytime I used to work and I kind of still do in some capacities at factory or warehouse settings, where the reward of working 12-hour shifts, 16-hour shifts, getting your ass fucking ripped in half for production. Mm-hmm. Your reward is, well, on Friday, we're going to have a lunch appreciation.
Yeah, pizza party.
We're having a pizza party.
We're having a fucking pizza party.
This is sort of like a capitalist version, grandiose, you know, conglomerate version.
Absolutely
of,
is.
Of the pizza party of like, these are the real heroes, everybody. Yeah, how about all the millions and billions you're making.
Yeah, it's so
support these
up.
Fucking people.
You know? It's so yeah. fucked up to me.
It is.
Basically,
burn it all down. It's all
and
bad.
The people who were like protesting out there, like literally gathering en masse to do this, instead of protesting, hey, I want fucking human rights. I want literally what every other country that has way less money than us is getting as a citizen, a tax-paying, hard-working American citizen. Instead of saying, hey, do more for us, we're such indoor cats now. We're so whipped by mm-hmm. this notion that we don't deserve more. It's not about mooching. It's so not about being a moocher. Like, I am the guy that I'm going to work until I fucking die. I'm a hardworking
and person. I know that of you. And just for the people who don't know Zach, he is speaking the every truth of that. I've seen him do it since I've known him.
Yeah, like I'm a person that I don't do well without a purpose, you know? It's idle hands.
You need something, yeah.
Yeah, that's why I am 100% into everything that I do.
Right.
I'm not going to just poo-poo out on something. And so, like, I understand that. But to think that because we live in America, the land of pull yourself up by the bootstraps and rugged individualism, which is awesome. That's super great. Self-made people, hardworking people, you're fucking sweet and you deserve my respect. But it doesn't mean that this system can't be doing more for us. The things that every other civilized country that we look down upon have already figured out, and all their citizens are benefiting from it and are way happier from it, and it hasn't just turned into some giant lazy welfare no one's willing to work state. And of course there are those people who take advantage of these kinds of systems. That is a thing that pisses me off as well, because it makes it harder for everybody else who should be deserving of it to get it,
right?
Why can't we just be like every other country? Every other place where you're like,
because we're making America great again!
Yeah, like it's starting to kind of really look like not that great around here, guys.
Yeah.
That's my political stuff. Like, I'm going to run for president in 5 years when I'm 35. And I'm going to be like, Zack Jacobs, it's starting to really not look that great around here, guys.
What's funny?
25.
I used to have, when I wanted to be a stand-up comedian a long time ago, which a lot of doughy white guys tend to do, I think. I used to have a bit about, like, you know, having the political platform in this moment of, like, standing before Congress and just going, all right, everybody, you know what? Come on.
Come on.
You know? Come on. And then, like, that role dramatic, just, like, one person stands up and is just like, and everybody's just like, yeah! You know, and, like, world peace happens because some people are like, what the fuck? Come on! Really? Come on! That's the platform. Just come on.
Just come on.
Come on!
My guy.
So, to kind of go back on track here, it seems to me, again, always correct me if I'm wrong, that the world happenings and the things that are currently happening amongst our government and corporations and stuff like that is what is continually motivating you towards your political spectrum. Is that correct?
Yeah, in a lot of ways. I'm trying to not let it radicalize me and shit. Like, I still want to remain an objective, 2 feet on the ground, eyes open kind of person and accept evidence.
Right.
Don't just accept something that someone says because I agree with them about another thing.
Right.
Like, don't get me wrong. I think that the left is full of fucking shit, too. They have their own special brand of bullshit.
And true.
It's a different kind of brand of bullshit from the right.
It all stinks.
It all, yeah. George Carlin said, 2 piles of shit, the only difference is the smell.
And but it it's still shit.
That
yeah.
does, but to me, that's true, but it also doesn't mean that you should just be apathetic and not work
that's
to make
true.
Your system better and make your representatives represent you.
Right. There's
like
still
we,
things you can
we pay them.
Do.
We give them their jobs.
Unless you want to go full Alex Jones tilt and, you know, it's, people behind the curtain.
The reptilians and the gay frogs.
Doesn't matter who you're putting on, but it is not 9/11. Yeah.
9/11 was done by the gay frog agenda.
You know what, Alex?
Let's not get into Alex
Jones. Let's not get into that.
This podcast
not
is
tonight.
Like 4 hours long. Yeah. Just running back and forth at each other.
That actually might come back around on the last question. So let's remember the blah 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 Bilderberg. Blah, blah.
All right.
All right. So we're gonna go ahead and move forward. The next question is: what, if anything, motivates you to continue to still give a fuck? Is it your spiritual beliefs? Is it an amalgamation of everything that goes on in your life and just who you've become as a person that you have just become a compassionate person and that's just sort of your nature? Or are there other things that influence you or inspire you to continue to give a fuck?
Yeah, I think all of the above, kind of.
Okay.
It's coming from kind of just because I'm not just my spiritual beliefs. I'm not just my political beliefs. I'm not just
multi-dimensions, yes.
It's all of it.
Mm-hmm.
And really kind of touching to like the subject at hand, the quarantine, the pandemic,
the roadies.
When it first happened, of course, you know, internally I'm like freaking the fuck out,
right,
and just losing it and going through it. But also I would come to these moments of resolution where I'm like, shit's gonna be okay, because to me, I can't wake up in the morning and go throughout a day if I believe anything else, you know, like the reason that I've been carrying on is because I think we're just like, this is a weird fucking time, but it's gonna be okay. We're gonna get through it. This isn't forever. This isn't life forever. It can't be.
Right.
Eventually, like if it goes on for actual ever, I will be out there and be like, open the beaches. We should all lick each other. I'm sick of it. Because I'm just gonna get stir crazy.
Right. So
I'm not a person that, like, I can't believe that shit is just gonna be fucked up forever.
Right.
You know.
So you have a belief in a future, and that's what motivates you to continue to try and be compassionate towards that future.
Yeah, and compassionate towards one another, because we're all going through it right now. I mean, this should be a reminder
right.
that we're always all going through it. This is just a specific, shared, fucked up experience for all of us.
Right.
And compassion is something that is going to make it way easier to get through. Like, we should come out of this. We have a really rare, unique opportunity to almost hit the reset button and come back and be like, let's have a better world now.
Right.
You know, I don't think that's going to happen. The cynic and the realist in me sees all the stupid bullshit.
Yeah.
Like,
it's the devil and angel on the shoulders.
It's probably going to be a little bit worse. You know, I remember 9/11. Everyone's like holding hands, singing Kumbaya for like 2 weeks, and then they're like, fuck the Democrats and fuck the Republicans. Like, how about
eternal struggle?
Love each other, man. You can disagree on shit. That's cool. That's fine. Like, we make each other better for that. I don't think that any one side should just have its way all the time. That would be stupid. That's not democracy.
See, that kind of moves me to my next point, my next question, I should say, because the third question I had, obviously, was, you know, what motivates you to be compassionate still and to give a fuck? You know, but the next question is...
But also, I don't know. I can't help but be compassionate and give a fuck. I am a bleeding heart asshole. I'm sorry.
Same. But I feel like, you know, something that we touched on was, you know, having multi-dimensions, you know, having a yin and a yang. You know, there's always an equilibrium in everybody where, you know, with every, you know, giant dose of optimism of like, you know what, we're all in this fucking, we're going to figure it out, it's going to be all right at some point, there's a large dose of, you know, the equalizer, I should say, of, it's all fucked! We're all going to fucking die. It's all bad. It's worthless. It's all nihilism.
My old friend nihilism, yes.
Old friend nihilism. So next question is, what, if anything, even if it's not, you know, anything substantial or permanent, but I have a hard time believing that there aren't days where there are things in the world that motivate you to just not care. Are there things right now that really kind of push you towards the idea of like, maybe I should say fuck it, if anything? No is a possible answer, but if there is things, I do want to open up on that shit because I'm struggling with that shit right now, honestly.
It's a struggle. I wanna say no, but also the truth is like there are things. Like for me, some of my biggest frustrations with how the world is right now, like not even right now, even before all this stupid shit.
Right.
But especially now, it's really coming to a head, is that this is 2020, right? We have access to the most information than we've ever had, the most knowledge than we've ever had in our fucking lives. Ever in human history, like you have a thing in your pocket that could tell you every fact of every piece of history that we know.
Right.
So what frustrates me is people that take that access to knowledge and seem to try to find their own truth about it in ways. And maybe I'm calling myself out for it. Maybe my spiritual beliefs are bullshit. And the truth is the Big Bang and all that stuff. And I mean, I believe in the Big Bang. Don't get me wrong. I'm a huge space nerd. But the people that are saying, well, okay, but I have read this article and it contradicts 72,000 peer-reviewed papers from people who have gone to school way longer than I have. It's almost this like flaunting of ignorance or throwing off really, really settled science and using it in a way of being like, I'm such a rebel, and I've got my own truth, and all this shit. When there is no excuse to be ignorant about shit anymore. You have the entire fucking database of information in the
what
world.
What the fuck? You literally have the encyclopedia of everything ever.
Of everything in your pocket.
Literally everything.
And I get it. I get it. A lot of times, the pocket rectangle
is full of misinformation.
Is full of other people that are just full of shit.
Mm-hmm.
Who have their own truth.
Well, actually, I read on Snopes.com that...
So, like, the things that make me... I mean, it can't make me not care anymore. It makes me even more pissed off, actually. It's the shit like that. Like, I see on Twitter protest flyers that are like, come protest the lockdown even if you're sick. It doesn't matter. It's still your right. Okay, No one's telling you that you don't have the right to free speech and assembly. That's the first fucking amendment. It's the first one. I don't know why it wasn't already in the Constitution. They had to amend it. Well, that's a whole other podcast. We can get into constitutional law.
But... yeah.
But it's so dangerous and so reckless and just the lack of empathy. If I get it, I get it. Like, okay, cool. If you get it, you might survive it. But, like, what about the girl that serves you your coffee at Starbucks who's immunocompromised and she can't pay her rent unless she comes to this job right now because the government isn't guaranteeing her enough money to pay her rent and feed her kid? What about her? Aren't you going to miss her when she fucking catches this shit?
Right. Like,
those are the things, like, I come from such a place of empathy and compassion that the absolute disregard and lack of that, it, like, baffles me to where I'm like, is this how it is? Is this how we are as a species? Because if that's how we're going to be, I'm sorry, but we fucking kind of deserve to just get wiped out. Start over again.
See? Okay. Shit's open right now. Hold on. I got a drink for this one. Okay, so something
I don't actually believe that. Like, I don't believe, like, everyone's really sweet grandma should die from this, or you or me. But, like, just the idea of, is this how far we've come? We have all this access to knowledge and information and each other. We are more connected than ever, and this fucking pandemic should show us that we are so connected.
And
to not have any respect or compassion or love towards that connection is it's sick to me.
Right. But here's the thing I'm struggling with. I hate that I had such a beautiful, you know, piece there and me interject with a, well, but, because it's not a but. It's just something I really struggle with.
Mm-hmm.
This entire thing is because I feel like we align pretty well on human empathy. And trying to do the greater good, you know, despite me continually battling doubts of, am I being a good person because it's the right thing to do, or am I being a good person because I care a lot about what people think of me?
Right.
But I've concluded through, you know, a good bit of scream crying and therapy, that I am programmed for a greater. Striving for towards the greater good, but there's a duality right now that is split with me, and you hit on it beautifully. Is you have these moments where you just kind of, you know what, everything is so fucking stupid, people are so fucking dumb, maybe we should just let that shit burn through,
right?
Because if you look at it from a scientific standpoint, this is what Earth does, this is what nature does. Diseases get created, new strains evolve, because we are overpopulated with fucking everything, pollution, human pollution.
Oh, yeah.
You know, that's what nature does. When a forest fire starts, what dies first? All the dead extra wood.
The Earth is really good at regulating itself and its system.
It's a goddamn regulator.
We're the number one thing throwing off every balance.
Right. And I hate, because I always crack up on the Twitter memes of, like, like, there's, like, a picture of, like, Timberlands. There's, like, somebody's Timberlands, and, like, Timberlands are coming back, you know, to their the natural habitat. Right. We were the disease after all, you know. Like, I'm able to laugh at that. But, goddamn, there's some of these times, like you're saying, there is literally no reason for such ignorance. Even my own. I have a lot of ignorance. I sometimes feel like, you know, the big old dad gutted old guy standing on his back porch going, you goddamn kids, sometimes. Mm-hmm. I do feel that way. And no, and I had that moment, you know, a couple weeks ago when I was driving through Bowling Green. I literally saw fucking Chads and dude bros having a fucking party on their front lawn. I'm just like, can we just live in a society, people? I almost went full tilt. And, you know, the reason why I have that as question number four is what motivates me some days not care. These are the big motivators towards that is why try when the majority doesn't.
Right.
You know what motivates you to still try? On the flip side, what motivates you to still try despite not many people doing it? And what I'm finding in this, and hopefully going to continue to find in this, is people's spiritual beliefs, political leanings, life experiences, you know, both good and terrifying, have crafted them into, you know, what motivates them for both the good and the bad. It's where we're at. It's the reality. We're here. I'm literally laid off again after working 1 week. So I'm back into the teenies. And because I was on the outside world, I'm going to self-quarantine myself for another 14 days. You know, it's not very fun. But that's why I'm doing this journey right now. This is why I'm talking to great people like you, into figuring all this out, opening it up, venting out a little bit, having a little bit of, you know, podcast therapy. But with everything in life, this is just how I am as a person. For those who ever watched Seinfeld, and I hate ever being that guy of like, I'm going to quote Seinfeld.
I'm surprised it took this long. I'm actually surprised.
Because I wasn't a big Seinfeld guy. I'm just going to put that out there. But you know what? When I use the term the George going Costanza, when like you want to leave a room on top, that episode where he wants to leave. If he leaves on a good note,
Yep. That's
the note that everybody's going to leave on.
You're going to leave him wanting more.
Yeah, leave him wanting more. There's a lot of spiritual alignment I have with the character of George Costanza. I'm sure people can probably tell that with me going, ah, da, 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 da. Yeah, that's just what I am, you know. And I do always want to I want to end these podcasts on a positive note or a high note, you know, because there's a lot of frustration in things, and it's very easy to not care. So my last question I have, to just maybe potentially lighten the mood, is what is your weirdest belief? What is a belief you have, whether religious, sexual, conspiratorial, but in the general population, when you want to talk about this shit, people are like, all right, dude. Okay. And if you're thinking about it, I'll give you my example.
Yeah.
And this is just me having essentially a little bit of a coming out party. I pretty much believe in Bigfoot. Now, okay. Preface with probably not. Logically and scientifically not sound whatsoever. But I have this real primitive draw to mysticism or in mythological and things that, you know, the idea of a Bigfoot is just so fucking good to me. I have a lot of part of me that I've watched a lot of documentaries, and I will fucking put myself in an echo chamber of scientists and cryptozoologists, right, who are going, oh, this is absolutely possible. And I'm just like, yes, give me all the facts.
Validate me.
I'm going to believe in Bigfoot. And I feel like damn near fucking insane sometimes if someone even, especially on the dating scene, when, you know, a woman I've been with or like I'm talking to, and they kind of bring up like, you know, like Loch Ness Monster or Bigfoot to be funny. And I'm just kind of like, but for real though, like, I'm going to talk about this right now, because I got literature, I got fucking documentaries on Fave, on Hulu, Netflix, and on YouTube. Oh, yeah. I'm pretty sure I got some Angel Fire and GeoCities links somewhere, you know? like nothing to make a pussy just go drier, you know? But that's an example for me that I'm probably going to use, you know, to kind of help, you know, give you a reference point of what I consider a quote-unquote weird belief.
Man, I don't even know where to begin.
Yeah, is it because you don't have any, or do you have quite a
few? Of course I have weird beliefs, so everybody has weird beliefs.
All right, yeah, this is the shit I'm trying to get to. We're opening this shit up.
I don't know where what to even think about. Like, what's the first one to talk about? Like, I don't even think that you're crazy in thinking that there is an undiscovered... We discover species and shit all the time.
Right.
Right?
You're just preaching the gospel to me.
Yeah. So, like, I'm not saying, like, what was funny to me, like, I used to, the show Ancient Aliens, when it came out, I used to be like, fuck yeah, that's my shit right there. Oh my god, like, and there was, like, they would, like, have good points, like, how did this really, like, ancient civilization build a giant stone sculpture that you could only see?
That's pretty fucking weird.
You could only actually lay it out flying above the earth. And it was, like, 10,000 fucking years ago, or whatever. So I used to be like, oh my god, yeah, what the shit? And like, there's still a lot of really weird stuff. You know, there's no such thing as an exact science to me, you know?
All right.
It's only as good as the tools which we use to measure it. And I think that that's not really a radical statement. You know, it can always be
fair. Fair. But has there been anything that you've talked about with somebody where they just looked at you like, what the fuck?
I mean, I don't even know if this is radical, because to me it is super duper logical in that it makes sense, you know, logic. Like, aliens, totally fucking real.
Okay.
Like, UFOs and stuff, and like every story about a crop circle or a probing or whatever,
mm-hmm.
Not everyone is probably true. I totally.
But
if you accept this current theory of the way that the universe is, in that there are just in our one galaxy 100 billion stars, that's stars, around which orbit planets, so 100 billion suns, you know, our solar system has like 8 planets. I'm sorry, Pluto, you're not a planet. That's actually, okay, you're maybe is that my weird belief? Pluto's not a planet. It's a trans-Neptunian object.
Size doesn't matter.
Okay, if Pluto was a planet, we would have to have, like, 30 planets, because there's a lot of other things that qualify under, that are the exact same thing as Pluto that we don't call planets. So, okay, there's weird belief one. But 100 billion stars, there's also 100 billion-ish observed galaxies. So right. Each galaxy has an average of 100 billion stars. Our universe, our observed universe, has 100 billion galaxies. How the fuck is it that we're the only game in town? It is literally mathematically,
logical.
I don't want to say impossible, because again, no exacts, but
so
mathematically insignificant that the same shit, because you look out in the universe and it's hydrogen, carbon, nitrogen, like it's all made out of the same shit.
Right.
So to think that the right stuff didn't come together somewhere else is really, really stupid.
Has there been anybody that's looked at you in talking about aliens? They're like, what the fuck are you talking about?
You know, you just heard me explain it. How could you disagree with that, right?
Right.
But yes, I think there's severely religious people that, like, it freaks them out to think about this thing, in that, like, we were made by God in the image of God, and that, like, Jesus came and, like, saved us, or whoever came and say, like, whatever, and we're, like, so special, which we are. Like, there's nothing, look around.
There's only one Earth, okay? One Earth.
That's true. One of a
one
kind.
One love, all right? But all also, you other fake Earths out there.
Okay, no, you know what? Now we're starting to get my wheels turning on my weird conspiracy.
All right, let's go, baby. Let's.
But are we the only Earth? Because think about the idea of the Big Bang, in that they have not found the edge of the universe. That's what the light horizon was.
Light horizon, yeah.
that's all we can really see right now. That's all the time that has been that light has had to travel that from our vantage point.
Right.
And if you think about infinities, then that means every possibility. And that kind of informs even my, that goes back to my weird spiritual beliefs is
everything in one.
What's outside of that? Nothing? What's right. nothing? How could that have existed before? And what's going, like, there, it either, the fact that I'm thinking about it isn't, means it's not nothing.
So and are you tiptoeing and dancing around multiverse?
I absolutely believe that there's a multiverse. Totally. Yeah. I think that we're a bubble in an ocean. A fucking bubble in an ocean. And even there is scientific data, like, there's things that we, in this, we don't understand. Like,
I saw Neil deGrasse Tyson tweet about this.
No, but like there's like dark matter,
right.
which right. is, they just call it that, but it really means extra gravity. Like,
right.
why? Why is there extra gravity? Without it, every computer model of a galaxy completely blows apart without all this extra input gravity that shouldn't exist out of a physical matter, like gravity, like causing it. So where the fuck is that coming from? Other than maybe it's like, here's a universe here, there's a universe there, and they're like kind of touching each other and pulling well, them together.
Like sort of like, you know, two male gay lovers who are like
they're docking.
Real apprehensive on docking, but they're kind of like sometimes with the yeah, tips do touch a little bit, you know?
They're right. they're really dancing.
I'm into that.
It's a big cosmic sword fight, if you will.
I'm into this.
But no, I think I really do think that, like, okay, look at like objective science. Like, when has the universe ever made one of a thing? There's not one sun. There's not one planet. There's not one galaxy. There's not one multi-galaxy. There's not.
There's one me. All right. There's one Earth. One God.
There just be one universe.
Yeah.
Why would there just be one universe?
That's fair.
Where the fuck did that bang come from? It was, my belief is, another multiverse collided with another multiverse, and in that like weird nebulous bubble thing collision, bam, a universe.
Yeah.
That's what it blows my. It's
universe
like
A, universe B, they come together, have a little bit of you know what's going yeah. on. They have yeah. their cummies. Our yeah. universe as we know it.
And now REO Speedwagon exists. Yeah, because two universes pumped into each other.
In a different universe, though, yeah. REO Speedwagon, vastly different genre.
Or doesn't exist at all, or is the biggest band of the world, which to me they are. No, I'm just kidding. But it's the infinite, like that's probably my weirdest belief is my belief in infinity. Like to take it to its, like the
furthest right. logical yeah,
conclusion. Is that every like there is a universe in which probably right now I'm hosting the Shits Open podcast and you were my guest or the Shits Closed podcast.
We're shutting this shit down.
We're gonna shut the shit down. We're not gonna talk about our feelings. Like it's just us for like 4 hours. Like, so how about all this weather we've been having?
You know, did you watch the NFL draft? And, you know, it was pretty interesting. You know, I feel like Bill Belichick's on his trajectory here and replacing Tom Brady, you know.
So, you know, if we have to accept these weird concepts, we have to follow them to their next logical conclusion.
Right. And what's funny is there was a comedian, Kyle Kinane.
Mm-hmm.
He had a bit, and it was about believing in God and believing in aliens. And... You know, I'm going to be butchering the bit, but essentially the bit synopsis is saying, if you're willing to believe, you know, in aliens, you're just as almost fanatic as a religious nut. You know, he goes, I'm like 95% aliens, and 5% God, but like, meaning, you know, he'll repent for his sins but as long as he's on the motherboard. You know? But, you know, it was essentially he was talking about his frustrations with atheists and going like, you know, you're stupid, you're sky daddy or whatsoever. And then you ask that same person of like, what do you think about aliens? well, it would be ignorant of me to think that we're alone out here, you know? Right. Like, it's all there, you know? Like, come on.
Well, only a Sith deals in absolutes.
I'm going to fucking throw something and Kool-Aid through a wall.
Hey, I learned that from Aliens.
I'm also, side note, I apologize. Intermittently throughout this podcast, there are a lot of small-dicked people in my town who go up and down our main street here and go, bah! So I apologize for that.
Good old Gibsonburg.
Good old Gibson Tucky. Love it. But that concludes my questionnaire and concludes opening our shit up a little bit. Thank you, Zach, for fucking hanging out with me. It's fucking 10:30 at night now. Shit, we opened shit up a little bit. I got a little bit of a buzz going.
That's a boy.
So, yeah. This has been...
I feel like we just started opening shit up, too.
Oh, well, this is just like a pilot episode.
Have me back, Ian.
You'll be back! Fuck it, you can just be a co-host. I don't fucking know what this is going to turn into.
What the fuck else do I got to do, man?
What the fuck else do we have to do? Okay. All right. Well, until next time. Thank you, Zach. Thank you, Kroger employees.
Our heroes.
Our heroes.
And you are heroes, but I mean that, and your boss doesn't. He just wants you to die for $7.25 an hour.
All right, until next time, we'll see you guys. Bye.